thank you all for coming tonight to hear a presentation about Cuba. It's not often times that I come up this far in northern part of Georgia to do a presentation on Cuba. Usually it's around Atlanta, so it's actually, thank you all for coming out for this. And I certainly enjoyed the drive. I came up for Tucker, so it was a bit of a haul. Incidentally, 400 is useless. Yeah. All the way out here. Thought I'd throw that in, but I think you all knew that. So let me introduce myself. My name is Alex Jimenez. I am not here in this capacity, but not only am I somebody who is the son of Cuban immigrants and Argentinian immigrants, they came over here in 1961. I was born here in the United States. Let me just clear that up at the front. I'm an American citizen. I was born here in the United States in 1962. But I also like to point out that I'm also the third vice chair of the CAB GOP. Please don't hold that against me. And I'm with the CAB GOP. So I am somebody who's in the Republican Party, and I've been in the Republican Party since I was 18 years old when I cast my first vote for Ronald Reagan. I canvassed for him in 1983, and I also voted for him again in 1984. So I'm a dyed-in-the-wool Republican, and I'd like to point out that typically, Cuban Americans, at least during my generation, all of us were very conservative Republicans. So the entire exiled Cuban community, you may have guessed, because of the anti-communism, because of the Cold War, were staunch Reaganites. We didn't like socialism, we didn't like communism, we loved the United States. Simply because they opened their arms to us when no other country would take us, because the communist revolution took over my parents' country in 1959. And so that's kind of the backdrop. And the reason I'm sharing the story tonight is because so much of what's going on in Cuba isn't being reported, and whatever is being reported isn't being reported accurately. As we know, surprise, surprise, we have a liberal media. We have a left-of-center media, if not sometimes outright socialist or outright communist. And so they're not in a big hurry to expose one of their heroes. And who is their hero? Their hero is Fidel Castro. Their hero is Raul Castro. Their hero, and what they look up to is what they believe are the accomplishments of the Cuban Revolution. They also look up to the guy in the t-shirt. What's that guy that everybody wears on a t-shirt? Che Guevara. So Che Guevara is another icon. I hope to tear that icon down tonight before I'm done in 20 minutes. I believe about 20 minutes?
Sure.
20, 30?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I hope to tear those icons down with some facts, along with Raul and along with Fidel. So without any further ado, tonight's presentation is called Cuba's Plantation Economy. By the time I'm done, I'm going to prove to you that it's not the external embargo that is what we should have been focusing on. The external embargo actually worked out beautifully for Cuba, because they were actually able to trade with every other nation on earth, except the United States. Dean Rusk, giving a speech before the Organization of American States, specifically said that the embargo's purpose was to contain Cuba and Russia's, or Moscow's, support of international terrorism. Some of you may remember that far back, that the original speech was to contain communism, to contain the Soviet Union, to contain Cuba in the Western Hemisphere. It wasn't for regime change, it wasn't for any of those other reasons, but to control international terrorism, which Cuba has outdone itself with. And so Cuba's plantation economy, the reason it's called that is because there's an internal embargo. And I'm going to show you what that internal embargo looks like and what it sounds like, so I'm going to be reading some documents. The internal embargo basically excludes Cuba from the economy. It is a company town. How many of you have heard of company towns from the 19th century, where if you worked in a mining town, you worked in the coal fields, you worked in certain industries through the late 19th century, you were paid in scrip, you weren't paid in hard currency, and you had to buy everything in what? The company store. I'm going to show you that Cuba runs like a company town, which is not good for any of the Cubans. So before I get started, let me just show you, these are the popular images that you're accustomed with Cuba. Most of you understand Cuba from the perspective of Ricky Ricardo, right? Lucy, I'm home. So a lot of people's understanding of Cuba was limited to their experience with Lila Lucy. Of course, we know what movie this is, Scarface. And so we have an understanding of Cuba. Some people's knowledge of Cuba extends only to the movie Scarface, which is really scary. And here we have a scene from what movie, The Godfather? Some people believe, or their only understanding, is that Cuba was a haven for organized crime. And that's their own entire understanding of Cuba. Their only other understanding of Cuba is white sandy beaches and Cuban cigars. And that's about as far as it gets. Doesn't go any further than what we see the images of in the popular culture. What I'd like to kick off is just a discussion. I'll be happy to read from some documents. It's just a discussion. I'm going to leave these images up, because the discussion starts like this. I'm going to go point by point on some of the things that you don't know about Cuba and don't know about the typical Cuban citizen living under the Castros. First of all, if you go to Cuba and you go to one of these white sandy beaches, your belief is that whoever is serving you a drink, a cold drink on that sandy beach, that the money that they're being paid is actually going to reach their pockets. Now, what I'd like to point out is in 1959, there was a decree, and that decree abolished all of the labor unions in Cuba, all of them. And what they gave up was the 40-hour work week. They gave up paid vacation. They gave up maternity leave. They gave up the 40-hour work week. They gave up collective bargaining. They gave up everything. Actually, they were forced to give it up because the person who was in charge of all the unions basically betrayed them to the Castro regime. And what the Castro regime did is replaced it with one central union, one employment agency. So let me walk you through this. If you go to Cuba and someone's serving you on a beach a drink, that person is not allowed to contract, to form an employment contract with the hotel you happen to be staying at. And the reason for that is whoever that is has to get approval from the local party, the Communist Party in Cuba. Imagine if you wanted to get a job and you had to go to the local Republican or Democratic Party, and they have to give you a letter of good standing. The state party has to vouch for you, and only then will you be allowed to approach the employment agency and ask to work in a hotel. But it gets better than that. A Cuban citizen who wants to work in a hotel is basically sold by the one employment agency run by the Castros to the foreign regime, to the foreign company. Not regime, foreign company. The foreign company will typically pay anywhere from $500 to $1,000 a month for that employee. And the first thing I'd like to show you is something that the Brookings Institution, they actually did a study. The Brookings Institution, in a paper called The New Cuban Economy, wrote Roles for Foreign Investment, Latin America Initiative at Brookings. Let me describe what they found. It's the world's heaviest tax on labor. The most unusual characteristic of the Cuban foreign direct investment regime is that the labor contract system. Foreign direct investment firms are not generally allowed to directly hire labor. Rather, a state employment agency, the only one the Castros run, a typical dependency of the relevant sectoral ministry, hires, fires, settles labor disputes, establishes wage scales, and pays the wages directly to the workers. The payments are paid to the state employment agency, which in turn pays the worker. So the worker that's actually taking care of you on the beach never sees the dollars, never sees the euros. It goes to the employment agency run by the Castros. You say, well, what do they pay the workers in? They get paid in non-convertible Cuban scrip money, about 20 pesos worth. Let's walk through that again. $500 is what they sold it to the foreign concern for, that individual worker, or 500 euros. That worker never sees the money. So the first myth is that opening tourism to Cuba is going to help Cubans. It is a lie. They will never see a dollar that you put in the pocket of that hotel for any of the bills, any of the credit card transactions, any of the cash transactions. It does not go to that worker. It goes to the Castros. The Castros pocket the cash and give that worker 20 pesos of Cuban scrip. And guess what they're invited to shop at with those 20 pesos of Cuban scrip? They're invited to shop at the Castro company stores. They're not called Castro company stores, but what you're confronted with is scarcity, staleness, and rotten food, and not much of it, and very little to wear. Which is why when you see real photographs of Cuba, you see people that don't look real healthy and they're not very well dressed, is because they live as chattel property of the state, and they never make a dime off of all their labors. So that's the first thing I'd like to clear up. Just so you know, some of you who are technically inclined, it's a 90% reduction. It is a 24-to-1 conversion ratio. So 500 pesos, 500 euros, $500 becomes 20 pesos. And one Cuban worker remarked to the author of the study for the Brookings Institution, in Cuba, it's a great myth that we live off the state. In fact, the state lives off of us. So there's the first myth that I'd like to explode, is that if you should travel to Cuba, which I hope you do not, the workers do not benefit. The second issue has to do with property.
Okay, we need to move the rock out so the door.
So the question I have, so the observation I have, let me close this door. The second myth that I'd like to explode is, well, at least the typical Cuban lives in a home or an apartment complex or a tenement building. Well, let me just point out something about all the buildings on the surface of the land in Cuba. My parents fled in I believe it was March 1961. It took them about a month to get here. They had to stop in Panama. They arrived in Miami, and it's kind of an anniversary for us. We arrived April 28th, 1961. I was born in August 1962. Now, those dates are very significant. April of 1961, Castro had not yet signed a decree confiscating all property. So my parents are in Miami. I'm not born yet. They're there with my brothers. They've lost everything. They've taken everything from them. They've had to leave everything behind, their home, and I'll show you what their home was like. My parents had a beautiful home on what's called Embassy Row. My parents were upper middle class. They were politically well connected. They were professionals. And they lived on the equivalent of Rodeo Drive, or Ocean Drive in Miami, the equivalent street in Cuba. It's a beautiful home, and their place of business was only a few blocks away. They used to walk to it. And there was a park nearby. I'm going to be passing out family photos. When I'm mentioning some of them, if you happen to be holding one of these photographs, I'll tell you what you're looking at. You're going to see my family photos. They are originals. So if you're passing it around, please be very gentle. They are family heirlooms. I will be happy to pass those out. So anyway, the second has to do with property. First, we're talking about labor and payments. The second one is property. Does anybody own any property? Well, this is the law of the Castro decree that took all my parents' money and property, and that of every other Cuban. Council of Ministers, Law 989, 1961, by Osvaldo Dorcatos Torado, President of the Republic of Cuba, a figurehead Castro was behind him. This is the declaration. Being known, the Council of Ministers agreed to sanction the following. Whereas it is clear that some persons belonging to classes affected by the measures taken by the revolution, who possess an unforgivable disdain for the motherland, have left the country. Disdain. 24 hours a day executions, thuggery, shooting police officers, shooting people in the streets, rounding people up and jailing them randomly, terrorizing every city in Cuba. You have a disdain if you leave Cuba. Whereas the majority of these persons own various goods that should be made available to the people, since which regulates departures and returns to and from national territory, also regulates the use of abandoned property. How convenient. They manage the entry and exit and the property of the island. Therefore, in exercise of the powers that have been conferred, the Council of Ministers resolves and dictates the following. Article 1. It is the authority of the Ministry of the Interior to grant exit and return permits of persons within the national territory. If the return does not take place, then who's in a hurry to come back? Anybody? If the return does not take place within the period for which it has been authorized at departure, it is considered that the person has abandoned the country. Let me put this in perspective. The reason you're fleeing is because family members and friends have been executed. They've been either shot in the street or shot in the companion prison fortress run by Che Guevara himself. And if you're a Catholic, I suggest you get a book that's written by Father Javier Arzuaga. He is someone who wrote a book called Before Midnight. And he was the priest who gave the last rites at the Cabana prison fortress where everyone was being executed by Che. And so he actually broke the silence in 1985 and tells the world in the book what a bloody murderer Che was. To give you an idea of what a bloody murderer he was, put this in context and why you're not coming back. Is that Javier Arzuaga gives testimony in his book, again, he is a Catholic priest who gave last rites to everyone executed, said that Che's favorite thing to do, people who were being scheduled for execution had their families visit, and of course they wanted to see them before they were executed. Che would walk families by the wall where everyone was being executed, covered in blood, skin, brain matter, stuff all over the ground. Che would walk families by that wall, that blood-soaked wall, to terrorize them. This is the Che Guevara that's on their shirts, by the way. So nobody's in a hurry to come back when news of that horrible scene percolates to the island. That Che not only enjoys killing his enemies of the revolution, but does so in a very grotesque, in a very cruel way, in a very torturous way. So if the return does not take place from the period for which it has been authorized at departure, it is considered that the person has abandoned the country. Article 2, in cases of persons understood to be those in the second paragraph of the article, this is what they take from you. All real estate, any other kinds of rights or shares, securities of any kind, shall be construed as nationalized for confiscation in favor of the Cuban state, which are assigned to the relevant agencies. So if you leave, they open your bank account, they go into your equivalent trading account, they take everything, they take your stocks, they take your bonds, they confiscate it all and take it. And this is probably the most horrible one of all. Article 4, they will take motorized vehicles, whatever their class, which was referred to in the prior article above, and they will be occupied by the Interior Ministry, I love the word occupied, which will transfer them to the appropriate public entity. This is what they take from your house and keep it. art objects, paintings, jewelry, valuable clothing, and food, we transfer to the Superior Council for reform. Therefore, be it ordered that these executed laws in all its parts, given this day in the Presidential Palace, December 5th, 1961, Fidel Castro Ruiz. His signature on that decree is signed. So when you visit Cuba, here's the scene. You're talking to an employee of a hotel or some business. They're not getting any of your money. And the building you're standing in, it's a rented home, and that's the third item on the list that I'm going to be talking about. The rented house, or the house you're thinking of buying in Cuba, was what in 1961? Stolen. So if anything, we have a regime that traffics in stolen property. I think it's a felony in the state of Georgia. If you either transfer or sell or deal in stolen property, you go to jail for that. But yet, if you're a country with a flag and a national anthem, you have Obama making diplomatic openings to you. I still haven't been able to square that. So if you visit Cuba and you're standing inside of an older home, that home was stolen from its owners without restitution. Now, to add insult to injury, if you go to Google and you type in Cuba real estate, guess what you're going to see? Homes for sale. And I'm going to just zip through these. And I'd just like to say that it wasn't unusual. This is a scene very, very familiar to Cubans. Cubans used to arrive on airplanes like this, Pan American being the one that they remember the most. We remember it fondly, Pan American, because we escaped from being on Pan American. My parents were on a branded flight, same difference, in 1961. And it wasn't unusual, just to let you know, Cubans did arrive and kiss the ground, almost routinely. On television, in the newspapers, they always kissed the ground when they got here. Very happy to be in the United States. This is Javier Arzuaga giving last rites. This is the man who wrote the book about Che. And so when we talk about Che Guevara, we talk about the regime. We have the testimony of Javier Arzuaga. I highly strongly recommend that you seek out his book. Last rites. I'd like to point out that he became a minister in the government. And what he shot here, and this is, actually I'm going to interrupt myself and call this the third item, the fourth item, I'm going to skip ahead. Who did he just shoot? That is the police chief. The Castro regime is a band of cop killers. How many feel good about cop killers? Anybody? Well, here, let me turn down the first icon, which is Fidel. Let me just rip him from his medal and from his pedestal and throw him to the ground. Fidel started his criminal political career by shooting a police officer point blank and murdering him. That's how he began his career. And this is how it happened. Fidel Castro was running for student body president at the University of Havana. His nemesis, his opponent, was shot and killed. Fidel Castro was supposed to go to trial for murder. The only eyewitness was a young police officer, a young university police officer, who one day was playing on the steps with his daughter on his knee, and guess who walked up and shot him in the chest? Fidel Castro. Fidel Castro is a cop killer. Point blank range, shot him in the chest. How do we know this? Because you have Rafael Diaz-Balart. Rafael Diaz-Balart is the father of the two Diaz-Balarts that were in Congress. Some of you may be familiar that there are Cuban Americans in the U.S. Congress, one of them being a Diaz-Balart. Rafael Diaz-Balart is the father of that man. Rafael Diaz-Balart gave testimony in the Senate in 1961 where he talks about that incident, that Fidel started his career by shooting a police officer in the chest and killing him. Now, when they took over the island, I just wanted to let you know that it was routine for the revolutionaries to dress in green fatigues. Sometimes they didn't dress in green fatigues, as you see. To go about the island killing sheriffs, police officers, and police chiefs routinely, tying their hands, putting them against a post or a wall and shooting them. Why would they get rid of the police?
Authority.
The police were the most closest protectors of the local population. That's why the Castro government targeted all of them and murdered them. So cop killers is the one I'd like to add. That's number four. Let me jump back to number three. Item number three. Parents' neighborhood. Let me just go on. That's the old neighborhood. That's the house that was taken. You see what they're sitting inside of? That was taken by the Cuban government in a decree I read. Those are my parents. It's my mother, my father, and my two brothers. So imagine you're sitting in Miami in 1961. You left all that behind. And you read it in the paper that the house that you took all these pictures in is gone. Taken by the government. And you have nothing but the clothes on your back in April of 1961 sitting huddling in Miami. This is the kind of life that they had. Upper middle class, all handmade clothing, handmade shoes. That's a Google Earth photograph of the house. That's where we think it is. That's the view to the ocean. This road is called Quinta Avenida, Fifth Avenue, very exclusive neighborhood. So I have been able to locate it. Back to item number three. If you type in Google homes, or Cuba homes, Cuba homes for sale, for rent, you're presented with real estate websites where the Cuban government sells you or rents you houses. That they what? Stole from everybody in 1961. Have they paid anyone a dime for this? No, they've made no restitution. In fact, the Obama administration has been hearing Raul and Fidel say, what? You owe us money? We want you to pay us restitution? Well, what about the billions that they took from individual citizens and businesses in 1961? They haven't paid up for that. In fact, they're selling, dealing in stolen property on the international market. That's my parents' shop. Those are my brothers and my parents' shop. This shop was right up the road from their house. This shop was visited by guerrillas and a Jeep with a machine gun on the back, guns in the holster to basically extort my father out of the air conditioning, unit on the roof, a very expensive one, because it was going to be given to a party official. They literally put a gun to his head to take it. Okay? And that business was confiscated along in the decree of 1961. Big difference. I'm going to show you how my mother used to dress. This is how they look like when they arrived in the U.S. You can see they're not real happy. They've had everything taken, and they're not combed. My mom has no makeup on. You can probably guess where I am. That's here in Miami. I can't believe they haven't valued, but they have one. I'm in there somewhere. You can figure it out. And there I am. This is the house in Miami. We did not get public assistance. We got here legally. All the paperwork was handled with embassies and consulates. So we did have all our paperwork. I did go through the paperwork in November of this last year. I visited Miami. We found all the documents that my mother had amassed. It's about 60 documents from various ministries and at least three embassies and two consulates. So we did enter the United States legally. We got here with all the documents and we waited patiently for our green cards. They got their green cards. Of course, I was born here. And later they all became American citizens. every I was dotted and every T was crossed. So this is in Miami. Probably figure out who I am. So while this is all going on, Castro's embracing Nikita Khrushchev. He's also talking to Ernest Hemingway. He's having a grand old time. A celebrity, by the way. You know the guy in the lower right is, right? He's having a cigar. People have been executed and murdered and their property confiscated, and he's having a cigar with Fidel. And there is Fidel having, I guess, lunch in Siberia with Nikita Khrushchev. And of course, Castro, of course, is a doll. In the lower right-hand corner, you see a picture of a medal being pinned to his chest by the late North Korean dictator. And of course, we see the other thug, which is Vladimir Putin, and yet the biggest thug of all, Xi of China, who sent an arms shipment, by the way, to the FARC guerrilla. The FARC guerrillas in Colombia are still a holdover of the old communist guerrilla organizations. Narco-terrorists, half the world's cocaine is handled by the FARC. Who does the FARC in Colombia credit for their ability to have all this military prowess, all this military hardware, all this training that allows them to terrorize Colombia and various parts of Latin America? Who do they credit? Fidel Castro. Thank you, Fidel, for training, from turning us, what did they say, from a hit-and-run band into an organized army. That's the FARC. This is the Fidel Castro. This is the Fidel Castro that we lionize and consider a celebrity. This is someone going to be shot. Who is that? That's a picture you don't see on the front page of the New York Times. This is Raul Castro. And that's Fidel tying his hands behind his back. This is a hapless volunteer who they believed was not on their side completely, so they had him shot without trial. There he is lecturing, someone who is living in the countryside. And I just want to point out that he not always wore fatigues. Actually, he's playing guerrilla, because that's how he really dressed. Fidel Castro was upper middle class, wealthy family, went to prep school, finest universities, was becoming a lawyer. He actually lived the life. He was a playboy, rabble rouser, fighter, brawler, just a ladies' man, and dressed very well. Designs on power, and he was considered part of the upper classes, which is why the richest classes, the upper classes of Cuba, actually financed his rise to power. Everybody thinks it was a bottom-up revolution. It was not. His demagoguery, his ability to persuade large crowds, definitely played a role, but all the money came from the wealthiest families of Cuba who wanted to replace Batista. So it was an internal coup by the power structure, the actual upper echelons of Cuban society, that replaced them. The reason I know that is my father was part of what knew all of those people in the upper echelons of Cuban society personally, and he was also friends with U.S. Ambassador Earl T. Smith. Now, Earl T. Smith wrote a book, which I highly recommend that you find. He is our U.S. ambassador. He was our U.S. ambassador to Cuba. It's called El Cuarto Piso. He spoke fluent Spanish. The book is called The Fourth Floor in English. If you want to know exactly how the Cuban Revolution went down, this is the only book that will tell you in detail how it went down chapter by chapter. I hope you find it. It's by Earl T. Smith, The Fourth Floor. And so he documents essentially what I heard my whole life. My dad told me everything about the Cuban Revolution, as did hundreds of other Cubans. I just want to let you know that what I'm sharing with you also comes from the verbal testimonies of people who floated over in rafts, who were dissidents, and who were defectors. I've spoken with people who have come up on rafts, who have crossed the Mexican border, and have gotten to Miami any which way they possibly could. So I've actually heard the first-hand eyewitness testimony of what it's like to live there. And secondly, I've heard the stories from people who were politicians, who were judges, who were lawyers, who were doctors. I grew up around these people in Miami, and they all said the same thing. Everything I'm sharing with you is their testimony as well. And so there's Chet. Chet's favorite thing to do was to shoot people in the head.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. What do you think changed his image so that now people want to wear my shirt? Why do you think his image is changed like that?
Because they've concealed his real past. For example, Motorcycle Diaries. They made a movie called Motorcycle Diaries about Che Guevara. There are sections of the Motorcycle Diaries where he's very violent, and he calls for murder and death on Americans. That part didn't make it into the Motorcycle Diaries. Also, his personal letters to his father, his letters to various parts of the world, various individuals writing him, he basically confesses and outs himself. And in fact, there's one letter to his father that says, "You know, Dad, basically I've learned that I really like killing people." He actually writes that to his father. And so I think what's happened is that the center left, the communists, the socialists, who dominate the media, don't want their icon sullied. They need him. They need him to be an icon, to rally people around. And so they don't want that side of his history. There's a whole history of Che. I could do a whole presentation on Che. But Che was a psychopath. He enjoyed killing people. He relished it. Javier Arzuaga, the Catholic priest who gave his last rites, was with him for a whole year, day in and day out, and got to know the real psychopath. And that's not making it into the Hollywood movies. So this is what life was like in Cuba. Life was like in Cuba was, it was a hustling and bustling, very prosperous nation, one of the most economically advanced, socially advanced. Their 1940 constitution is progressive even by 2016 standards. If you read their constitution, which was a constitutional republic, in its structure, it's very progressive. A progressive today reading the English translation of the 1940 Constitution, think they're reading something that would have been written by a modern progressive. It was very progressive, very advanced, hardly oppressive, very center-left. So we had Sears, we had Woolworth, very much like the United States. Television, radio. And this is what it was like, for example, in the country clubs. People lived very well. They were very prosperous. They didn't steal anything. They worked very hard for their money. I'm not going to get bogged down in a side trip. There's my mom. I'm going to point that picture out because this is her probably in late 1930s, 1940s. And you see how they dress. I'm going to show some very contrasting photographs of how everything looks today. This is my mother. She was a singer, dancer, actress, very well known. Beautiful voice. That's her. Some of her publicity shots. That's my dad. And this is pictures on Varadero Beach. So just to let you know that when I hear Varadero Beach, some people say, we're going to Varadero Beach for a vacation in Cuba. We're going to smoke a cigar. We're going to do this because we think Cuba's cool. Well, my parents, when they got engaged, were on Varadero Beach. So to me, it means something a little different. Okay, this is 1949, 1950. And that picture was taken. And this is probably the most beautiful picture of my mother. She's sitting on Varadero Beach. So when someone says, I'm going to go to Varadero Beach, I'm going to go enjoy Cuba because it's open now. Well, I just want you to know, to my family, it's a little more personal than that. A little more. As you can see from the photographs. This is Earl T. Smith. Earl T. Smith with his wife, with Batista, and with Kennedy. Most people don't know Kennedy had a back brace. He had a back problem. But there is Earl T. Smith with John F. Kennedy. Again, he was a good friend. You can see the before and after shots, the glamour shots of Cuba. Old Cuba's on the left. New Cuba's on the right. progress, would you say?
Yeah.
A paradise. So you saw the picture of my mother, you saw the picture of the upper middle class young women, debutante balls, very well dressed, going out for the night. Well, there's only really two options for you. You can either make a queue, if you're a woman, and wait for food all day long, never get paid any real money, or you can be a hinatera. Cuba is one of the largest centers of sex trafficking in the world. Most young women have to basically sell themselves to tourists to make ends meet. Or you can be conscripted in the army and be part of the political and military army that the Castros are famous for. Just to let you know, most of them are of color. And during the 1970s, Cuba was heard of Angola. The Castros were famous for renting out their army, their military, as mercenary armies for money, for cash, to communist governments in Africa. That was one of their main staples of converting hard foreign exchange, was to rent or pimp out the youth of Cuba, who, as you saw before, had a completely different life.
Angola.
Yeah, than the one they have now. As you can see, they do it to the men as well. Again, most of them are of color. And instead of a child growing up with dreams of becoming a singer or dancer like my mother in that photograph from the early 1930s, this is what you have to look forward to, being conscripted at an early age to be part of a political army belonging to one Fidel Castro and Raul Castro. So this is exactly what it's like to live there. That 20 pesos that you received, that you actually didn't get paid in hard currency, that's the line you make. There's lines everywhere, and you get that strip to buy whatever you can find. Okay, while the hotel is taking care of tourists, and why the Castros are pocketing the money. In 2006, this is the last estimate that was made of the Castro fortune. 2006, Forbes published a number. $1 billion is what Fidel Castro was worth. He was furious. Forbes never published it again. There was an incident, I think, 2 years ago, where, and this is also supplemented by a G2 defector, which is their version of the KGB, one of the bodyguards of Castro defected to the West. So I'm going to combine two sources into one. A story in Turkey broke where Alex Castro's bodyguards got into a scuffle with Turkish police. And while they were there, they noticed that he was there in the family's 167-foot yacht. The Castro dynasty, the Castro crime family, is worth billions, and they do have a 167-foot yacht that had just left the island of Mykonos towards Turkey, and Alex Castro was on it. They're multi-millionaires, this family has. He has 8 children, and they've all gone to excellent schools. Some of them help run the government. So he's built a dynasty on the backs of murdered and robbed Cubans. So when I hear the stories about Castro, when I hear stories about Cuba, you're dealing with what? You're dealing with a company town surrounded by water that people have no escape from. A little hard to talk about. And so as I'm wrapping up, and I'm thinking that I'm probably close to being out of time, and I certainly could cover more material, but this is the abbreviated version of the presentation. To add outrage to the situation, just to change the subject just for a moment. How many of you, obviously, this is a dumb question, we all remember 9/11?
Can we not?
Burning our memories? The towers blown up in front of our eyes. Well, October 3rd, 1962, Castro tried to do that to us a lot earlier than 9/11. Probably a story you never heard of. Allow me to read it to you. October 3rd, 1962, a few days before the onset of the Cuban Missile Crisis, Castro sent one of his trusted men to New York on a key mission. The man chosen for the job was Roberto Santebastian Casanova, who had just been appointed a minor post to the Cuban mission of the United Nations. His diplomatic passport identified him as an attaché to the Cuban mission. Santebastian's professional field, however, was not diplomacy. Quite the contrary, he was an expert terrorist. He was an expert in terrorist techniques, just graduated from the highly secret school of terrorism and subversion not far from Havana. As soon as Santebastian arrived in New York, he contacted the rest of the team, including Jose Gomez Abad and his wife Elsa, both attachés at the Cuban mission, and Jose Garcia Orellana, a Cuban immigrant who ran a costume jewelry shop in Manhattan. The Federal Bureau of Investigation, who caught them, estimates how many people were involved in the plot that I'm going to talk about, was from 25 to 50 people, 50 operatives. The secret mission that Castro had assigned them to this terrorist team, was to accomplish Castro's orders, ready, to blow up a big portion of Manhattan, including the Statue of Liberty, Macy's department store, several subway stations, the 42nd Street bus terminal, Grand Central Station, as well as several refineries along the New Jersey shore, including the Humble Oil Refining Company in Linden. To this effect, they stored a huge case of explosives Ed Garcia shot, the FBI foiled an attempt to have, to foist on us a 9/11 all the way back in October 3rd, 1962. How many of you knew that?
Didn't know that one.
That Castro had planned with over 500 pounds of TNT, was what they found, to blow up everything that I said. Had the FBI not intercepted them, would we have had a 9/11 before, back in 1962? Now, what makes it worse is the following. When the Soviet Union fell, the KGB archives blew open. At the same time he was doing this, he was calling Nikita Khrushchev. Nikita Khrushchev, trying to talk Nikita Khrushchev into this notion of the United States, it was an imminent attack from the United States on Cuba. Of course, we see the background, right? He was going to blow up something in the United States, and that the United States would attack. He was trying to trick Nikita Khrushchev into launching missiles against the United States. Fortunately, Khrushchev was not as crazy as Castro. Khrushchev, according to the Russian archives, says this man is out of his mind. Would you mind checking his story? They found that Castro had actually tried to dupe Nikita Khrushchev. He wasn't real happy about that. But not only was he trying to force a 9/11 on us, he was trying to start a nuclear war. That's Fidel Castro. That's what we're dealing with. The cop killer who shoots a man point blank in the chest with his daughter on his knee. That's what we're dealing with. So I'm going to start winding this down because I could go longer. How many of you feel that you know enough about Cuba now to understand that normalizing relations is wrong?
I've understood that from the get-go.
Okay. Medical care. This is the typical hospital for the typical Cuban. Everything's dirty, everything's on the floor, there is no medicine, there is no aspirin, there is nothing for anyone. That is for the typical Cuban. Operating salons are dirty and unsanitized, they've never been cleaned. If you want to get an x-ray, all the machines are broken. These are all taken undercover. This is the entrance to the operating room, it's never been opened, it is chained. Those are dental instruments in an actual, active, working dental office. Everything's dirty, there are no autoclaves, there is no alcohol, there is no running water, and there's no soap. So if you want something done with your mouth, they're going to use what's been shared with about 80 other people or 100 or whatever's been there for you. This is what's going on in Cuba. Now we understand why they're on rafts. Not hard to understand why they're floating away. If it were a miracle, if the Castros were indeed miracle workers and Cuba was a paradise, we would not have tens of thousands of Cubans losing their lives since 1959, actually since 1967 when he shut the doors really tight. We wouldn't have had tens of thousands, if not over 100,000 Cubans floating across the Florida Straits to Miami, many of them never making it to Miami, dying of exposure, and dying because they're eaten by sharks. Now imagine you're fleeing Cuba on a raft, your raft doesn't make it, and it is typical, it is not unusual to have found rafts with dead people on them. That's why in the old days, remember the 90s, there used to be patrols flown by Cubans looking for other Cubans on rafts. That's why they were doing that, because they were crossing the Florida Straits so they're shark infested. Just quickly, some resources, if some of you are readers. A book called Against All Hope by Armando Valladares. He is the Cuban Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who wrote The Gulag Archipelago. Russia had its Gulag Archipelago. We had Our Against All Hope, written by Armando Valladares. I highly recommend his book. He speaks before the United Nations and various international organizations. Antunes, 17 years in prison. He refers to himself as an Afro-Cuban, and he tells the story that Cuba it's wrong to put more money in the pockets of the Castros. What needs to happen in Cuba is regime change. This is a man who was in prison for 17 years. He also makes the case that Cuba is essentially a racist plantation economy because none of the leadership is black, number one. And if you are black, and I quote him, there's a 99% chance you're going to get the maximum penalty simply because you are black. And number three, all of the jails, according to him, are full of black people, Afro-Cubans. So it is a racist regime. So it is a throwback to the 18th century. So it's not only worse than being a plantation economy, it's not only worse than being a company town, it is an 18th century version of the company town, a throwback to the old colonial days when you had conquistadores, white Spanish conquistadores presiding over people of color. And so, as we wrap this up, I'm gonna actually send a letter to your email. It was written by Miguel Quevedo. He actually wrote a letter that chillingly describes how the communist revolution duped him, duped everybody, and he actually tells you, play by play, what went wrong in Cuba. And it is a cautionary tale I hope that you'll all read, if you can, if you all can forward that email to the group, so you can read that letter and translate it into English. There's Javier Arzuaga. Owe him a debt of gratitude. He is the priest, I'm telling you, who gave last rites. That's his book, that's in 1985. It tells the truth about Che and the truth about the Cuban killing machine. The importance of Cuba. The madman that's in charge of Cuba controls an island. This is Cuba right here that controls all the choke points in and out up to the Gulf of Mexico. Most of our refineries and tonnage and all of our economy, 7 of our 10 largest ports are here. Castro sits here. There's one choke point he can easily squeeze. Here's another choke point he can easily squeeze. Can anybody guess what sits right here on the eastern tip? Guantanamo Bay. Now we know why we have Guantanamo Bay. We can't lose Guantanamo Bay, because if he gets Guantanamo Bay, he pinches that shut, and everything goes through what? Panama Canal. So if he's able to cause literally a blockage here and a blockage here, he basically can shut down the Gulf of Mexico and the eastern seaboard. We'd be dead in the water.
That's why Obama wants that closed.
He wants to hand it back to them. Now, who's making very large investments in this entire area is Russia and China. China, through contract, controls the Panama Canal. Russia and China are building the Nicaragua Canal. And they're building military bases, and Venezuela in particular is allowing docking privileges for the Russian Navy. So essentially what's happening, if you're military or a veteran, China and Russia are taking forward positions in the Western Hemisphere. Right. Two generals, Generals Kelly and Tovo, gave testimony before the Senate in 2014-2015, basically said, we are vulnerable in Southcom, the Southern Command. We've never been weaker. And the Russians and the Chinese are engaged in a buildup in the Western Hemisphere. They're taking forward positions. We're going to be caught by surprise. He didn't say that word, but he came very close to saying that to Congress. We're vulnerable and we're weak. This, also in military terms, is an aircraft carrier. A landmass that big functions as not only a staging area, it's also an aircraft carrier that could easily help take the United States. So I'm just saying, in military terms, there's more on the table here than just cigars and sandy beaches.
Yeah.
Okay. So, mom and dad. Okay. That is the christening of my son, Alex. And I just want to say that I dedicate this to my mom. Mom was the one who got all the paperwork done. She is 92. That's still kicking. That's taken in November. What I'd like to do is, as you think of questions that you'd like to ask me, I'd like to pass this album around. These are family photos. And so with that, I open it for questions.
Can you send that email out?
Yes.
That map?
Yes, I can.
The whole presentation.
Yeah, I'm done, so thank you.
Sure,
thank you very much.
We'll post this on the website. We'll have a video, thanks to Nydia over there, who's
videotaping. And, I admit it's something that I just didn't know about. I mean, I've heard the propaganda, I guess, if you want to use that word, that, this is now, wow, we're getting ready. A friend of mine's a pilot, mm-hmm. and he said, we should go down there. I remain skeptical.
Yeah,
that's amazing.
Yeah, they have an answer for the crime. I mean, every other dictator in the world is either dead or has stood trial, like Slobodan Milosevic, or the crimes against humanity stood trial. The original dictator of North Korea has died, has passed. Stalin's dead, Lenin's dead, Hitler's dead. They're all dead except for one, Fidel.
Obama.
Yeah. All right. So Fidel is the icon to Cubans. He's our Hitler who's still alive. He's our Stalin who's still alive. And so it hurts when we see the world embracing him and wanting to do business with him.
How old are his kids,
His kids are in their 40s. And they're very well educated. Like I said, they've attended the best schools.
They active?
They are very active. In fact, the G2, which is their KGB defector in the United States, blew the lid off the fact that they have their own private island off the coast of Cuba, with multiple homes and multiple compounds. They live very, very, lifestyles of rich and famous off the coast of Cuba as billionaires.
When I talk to people that have been there and hit them, they're gonna say, well, I tipped the people. So when the people are serving them and they're tipped,
they have to give that money out.
Okay, how do they know?
Well, because there's an army of snitches. And I do wanna add that the family unit is completely destroyed in Cuba, because your family turns you in. Your uncles, your nieces, your nephews, your mother, your father, your sister, your kids turn you in. And if your kids turn you in, your coworkers are going to turn you in.
Okay.
And you're being watched at all times by a network of stitches informally, Also, the criminal network, which is tied to the government, is watching you.
Okay.
And so what they do is they do the old shakedown. They know you've got dollars, they know you've got euros, and they're going to 100%, they're going to take almost all of it.
And it's come back here. You couldn't spend it anyway.
And
they kept the money there.
Where? That's right. I think what they do is they use the money on the black market to get things that are very difficult to find, that they can't get with convertible pesos out of the company stores. So there is a black market that answers to a euro, that answers to a dollar, but it's all very, very hush-hush.
Is there any private ownership of land? I mean, do normal people own normal property at all?
No. Everything's on a string. For example, in Cuba, if you're a foreign business owner, and I did leave out one thing, which I'll cover quickly. If you're a foreign investor, you don't own the property the hotel's on, you don't even own the hotel. The kind of contracts the Cuban government signs with you is a management contract. You're allowed to manage the property. 51% ownership, I think, is the minimum that the Castro government requires. The other 49% is a foreign concern. And I do want to say one last thing, just the final outrage. A law was passed about a few months before normalization. It was law 188. 188 basically said the following, and it's outrageous to hear. If you're Cuban born, if you're born on the island of Cuba as a Cuban citizen, you are specifically excluded from being an investor in your own island. Let me run that by you again. So if you're a German or Italian or an Australian coming with money to invest in Cuba, if you're a Cuban citizen who's managed to scrape together a few stray bucks, you're specifically excluded, prohibited from being an investor in your own, in the nation of your birth. And when they asked the head of the assembly, the Cuban assembly, why that was, it's because they are not making any changes to the socialist system. They'll take foreign investors' money, but they're not going to change who they are. They're not going to change how they do things. They're not going to change the darn thing. By the way, if you're a Cuban citizen, you are specifically excluded, in addition to being paid in script, in addition to having had everything stolen and nothing belonging to you, in addition to having an army of snitches, in addition to having the kind of medical care, and you wanted to flee off the island in a rickety raft, on top of everything, you can't be an investor in your own country. You're not allowed to.
All right, thank you very much.